Hello, this is Osman Ceylan from Mavri Microwave. I'm a senior applications engineer. In this short course session, I'm going to present fundamentals of large signal characterization and high power amplifier design considerations. There are four main topics in my presentation today. First, brief information about large signal operation to explain how to achieve high efficiency and definition of load pull concept. Second, load pull measurement setup configurations, their pros and cons. Third, some important topics about RF measurements such as calibration, pulsed DC, and measurement uncertainty. And fourth, some recommendations to improve your design's performance and reliability. When we start talking about high power amplifiers, most of the talk is about its efficiency. Power amplifiers convert DC power to RF power and transmit it to the next stage of the transmitter system. If a power amplifier can convert all of the power consumed from the supply, it's a 100% efficient amplifier. In practice, we all know it's not possible. But we engineers always do our best to have the best efficiency to have a winning design. High power amplifiers should operate highly efficient, not only to save some power, but also to improve the device's lifetime and system's reliability. Because dissipated power means that the device and system heats up. Cooling is an expensive and physically large mechanism for the transmitter systems. In addition, for example, if you think about the number of installed base stations in the world, each 1% efficiency increment will turn to millions of watts of energy saving in total. A high-frequency transistor cannot be considered only as a voltage-controlled current source. There are other factors that have a direct impact on its performance, such as drain gate capacitance, drain source capacitance, and pads at the gate and drain. All these components affect the transistor's response and make it more frequency dependent. For example, if we ignore the parasitics, according to the load line theory, there is an optimum load resistance to maximize the output power, and it's a pure real impedance value. However, if we include the effects of parasitic components, the device reveals maximum power in a different impedance value. That's why most of the time the optimum load impedance is a complex impedance value in high-frequency applications. Moreover, we cannot measure the transistor's performance at current source plane. This will bring us to load pull measurements in the following slides. In this slide, I will show you two simulation results to explain how the current and voltage waveforms at the current source plane affect the efficiency of a power amplifier. If there is some voltage at the drain and current flows from drain to source at the same time, it causes power dissipation on the transistor, because electrical power is a product of current and voltage. Here, the red curve is the voltage and the blue curve shows the current. The pink area, which shows the overlapped area by the current and voltage waveforms, is the power dissipated on the transistor. If the overlapped area is large, it causes more power dissipation and the efficiency reduces. My examples here use the same transistor and the same biasing conditions. A load termination causing waveforms like the left one has 25% efficiency. If you can design a termination network providing waveform like the figure at the right hand side, the amplifier achieves 85% efficiency. As a designer, you are free to pick any load impedance and design the termination network. So, how do you know which impedance is the correct one providing a maximum efficiency? Load pull is the correct answer to find the required impedance to have the maximum efficiency or the maximum power. If you have a tool to change the load impedance and measure the performance, You can have a large signal-based performance data to evaluate the transistor's behavior and start designing an amplifier. In this measurement, I fixed impedance values at the second harmonic and third harmonic frequencies. Then I swapped the load impedances and measured the transistor's large signal response at different input power levels. The figure on the right-hand side shows how the efficiency and output power changed depending on the load impedance values. For example, if I want to design a power amplifier with maximum efficiency, I need to select an impedance value around here. Let's evaluate this load pull measurement data a bit more. I marked some efficiency values in this figure. It's very clear how the different load impedances affect efficiency and output power. As you also noticed, there is no one impedance value providing the maximum efficiency, power, and the gain at the same time. There is always some trade-off in high power amplifier design. Therefore, as a designer, you need to pick a suitable load impedance meeting your design goals depending on performance requirements of your amplifier and final system design. The most popular solution to have an adjustable impedance for RF applications is an impedance tuner. Basically, a tuner is a mechanical equipment and has a moving probe on a fixed transmission line. If you move this probe up, down, and right, left, you can control the impedance at the tuner's ports. The more accurate control of the probe means the more accurate and reliable impedance control. I will explain how we use the tuners to control the source and load impedances in the measurement setups for source pull and load pull measurements. The first measurement setup I will show you is a traditional load pull setup. In this configuration, the key components from left to right are signal generator, driver amplifier, input coupler, input tuner, output tuner, and power sensor. Usually, a software controls all equipment to automatize the measurement session. The tuners set the source and load impedance values at the transistor's input and output. The signal generator and driver amplifiers provide the RF signal to drive the transistor. Then the delivered power to the DUT is measured by the input coupler and power sensor. The software calculates the impedance values based on tuner's positions. Since the system measures the output power, delivered power, DC power, and impedance values at the source and load, it can calculate the important performance parameters such as efficiency and output power to display on the Smith chart using contours. This is a simple, cost-effective, and rapid measurement configuration. However, the impedance accuracy depends on tuner's impedance tuning accuracy. There is no way to measure the actual impedance created by the tuners. How can we measure the actual impedance at the source and load? A VNA-based measurement setup is the answer. In addition to S-parameter measurements, we can use the receivers of a VNA to measure the large signals with some modifications. In this schematic, there is a load pull measurement setup using a VNA. The injected and reflected signals at the input and output can be measured as vectorial quantities with the couplers before and after the DUT. Then the software can calculate the impedance values at the input and output of the DUT using the measurement data. Therefore, their accuracies are independent of the tuner's accuracy. This is the most important advantage of a vector receiver-based load pull. However, as you noticed, a VNA is needed for this configuration, and its cost is the dominant one in this setup. Impedance tuners are very useful and reliable equipment. However, we have to use other components in a measurement setup, which brings its insertion losses. Tuning performance of a tuner is limited with the insertion loss between the tuner and DUT. For example, a regular tuner can cover all the impedances in the blue circle. However, if there is a 1 dB insertion loss between the tuner and DUT, the tuner can control the impedance value in the red circle. If you consider An on-wafer measurement setup, you need a probe, bias T, coupler, several adapters and cables between these components. The total insertion loss could be high enough to shrink the area that the tuner can operate, especially at high frequencies. In some cases, the covered area might not be useful for your measurements. There is a brilliant solution to overcome this problem, and it's called active load pull. The definition of the reflection coefficient at the load is A2 over B2. B2 is the power delivered to the load from the DUT. A2 is the reflected power from the load. We can't control the B2, it comes from the transistor. But if we can control the A2, we can generate any reflection coefficient artificially. This is called active load pull. A phase and amplitude controlled signal generator and a driver amplifier can form required A2 signal to have the required load impedance. With this configuration, it's possible to achieve any impedance value on the Smith chart. Therefore, the insertion loss problem doesn't matter anymore. As you noticed, the main difference in this configuration, now we need a second amplifier at the output. The output power requirement of an active load pull system is usually 5-10 times larger than your DUT's max output power. If your DUT is a few watt, it's not a big problem. There are many commercial amplifiers available up to 30-50 watts. However, if your DUT is a large power one, such as 100 watt, then you may need a kilowatt external amplifier at the output. Then the cost of the measurement setup changes dramatically. It's more or less the same for millimeter wave and high frequency applications. In this range, DUT powers are low, but the power amplifiers are quite expensive. Of course, we engineers find ways to have affordable and feasible solutions. Wait and see. A hybrid solution consists of a tuner and active load pull system. In this configuration, the tuner supports the active load pull to reduce the required tuning power by making a prematching between the DUT and external driver amplifier. This schematic shows how to implement a hybrid solution. In this configuration, the insertion loss between the tuner and DUT is compensated by the external amplifier. On the other hand, the tuner provides prematching. Therefore, it's possible to tune the impedances at the load with less power. It's also possible to apply hybrid load pull configurations for fundamental and second harmonic frequencies simultaneously. The key component in this configuration is the diplexer. It splits the signal and provides independent control of the signals. In this configuration, load pull for the fundamental frequency is done by the tuner, and the second harmonic tuning is done by the active load pull. There is no reason to extend the configuration more. In this one, load pull configuration at the fundamental frequency has a hybrid structure, and the load pull at the second harmonic frequency is still an active load pull configuration. Up to now, I presented a traditional load pull setup and vector receiver load pull examples with active and passive solutions. VNAs are the key components for vector measurements. Although VNAs provide excellent noise floor and advanced measurements, they are narrowband measurement tools. Therefore, it's not possible to analyze wideband signals with VNA-based measurement configurations. It's possible to perform load pull measurements with wideband receivers. Wideband solutions for load pull measurements have significant advantages. We call it a mixed signal active load pull solution. A system like this has the capabilities of VNA, signal generators, spectrum analyzers, and tuners. A mixed signal active load pull can perform load pull with modulated signals, bütün many impedance values in one power sweep and apply active source pull. Dr. Mauro from Antaverta will present more details about it in this short course. After explaining several load pull configurations, in this part of the presentation, I will shortly talk about the key parts of a measurement process. Calibration is an essential requirement for all RF measurement setups. The real measurement plane of a load pull or S-parameter measurement setup is the inputs of the receivers in the measurement tool. However, there are many components between the receivers and the UT, such as couplers, switches, cables, biases, and etc. We need to exclude their effects and bring the measurement plane to the DUT's pads or package leads. There are three popular calibration methods. SOLT is the most known and popular calibration method. It uses characterized standards such as load, short, open, and true. They are usually wideband. The calibration kit manufacturers provide the components' technical information referring to an approved calibration standard. It's possible to have coaxial and planar SOLT standards. However, their accuracy is poor in the high reflection region. TRL calibration kit has two lines and reflex standard. The reflex standard can be either a short or an open. The lengths of the lines should be different than each other. It's an accurate calibration method. In TRL calibration, the reference impedance of the measurement setup is set by the characteristic impedance of the lines. Therefore, fabrication tolerances are dominant on the accuracy of the calibration. It's mostly used for on-wafer measurements for high-frequency applications. LRM is another popular calibration method. In this method, the key component is the matched load. It should be wideband and well characterized. The reflex standard can be either short or open. Every measurement provides only estimates of the measurement. We cannot have perfect and certain measurement data. There is always some uncertainty in all type of measurements. It's also the same for RF measurements. For example, in an S-parameter measurement system, there are five uncertainty contributions. VNA's drift and noise, cable's stability and reliability, connector repeatability of the all components in the measurement system, calibration kit definition, and operator's skills. Measurement uncertainty is a very important technical topic to understand the real performance of the DUT and limits of the measurement setup. A characterized measurement setup can provide uncertainty information. Please check the resources for the more information. In this slide, you see two S-parameter measurements with uncertainty information. The measurement setup and DUTs are the same, but the results are different above 15 GHz. So the question, how can you be sure about your calibration and measurement procedures? We know that the measurement equipment can provide only estimated values. Here, the lines in the yellow and purple areas are the estimated values of these measurements. Which one is the correct measurement? Which calibration is the most accurate one? This example displays the importance of measurement uncertainties, because your next measurement using the same device can be in these fields. Uncertainty information can also be used to evaluate your calibration. Depending on characterization and measurement equipment, measurement uncertainty can be extended for load pull measurements. The second figure here shows a load pull measurement with uncertainty on output power and power gain. In this slide, I will show you a design example to explain how uncertainty information can also be used for designs. If you measure S parameters of a transistor with uncertainty information, you can use these data to evaluate the final design, which could be an amplifier or a system. In my example, I used S parameters of an RF power transistor with a setup characterized for uncertainty added measurements. Then, I designed a narrowband amplifier at 2.4 GHz based on uncertainty added S parameters. To have the uncertainty added final results, simulation results are extended based on transistors' uncertainty added S parameters. There is no component tolerance in this example. If you look at the simulation results, the S11 uncertainty of the transistor is plus minus 0.07 at the beginning. If you design a circuit and evaluate the final uncertainty, it becomes plus minus 6.4 dB. Similarly, S21 uncertainty of the transistor is plus minus 0.07 dB. The final design has plus minus 0.5 dB gain variation. For example, if my final amplifier's design requirement is minimum minus 20 dB of S11, some of the amplifiers can fail the acceptance tests due to the uncertainty of the transistor's S11. Therefore, I need to design a better input matching network to avoid this variation from my final design. In addition to RF measurement equipment, calibration kit, and setup configuration, it's important how you bias your DUT and how you measure if you use pulse DC. I have two measurement examples here showing a pulse chronogram and the DUT's responses. Pulse response of a DUT depends on the biasing network and DUT's parasitic components. For example, long cables, biases having large capacitors and inductors, DUTs having large drain source capacitances can cause undesired responses at the beginning of a pulse. Therefore, you should set the pulse period and width by considering these effects. An oscilloscope view always helps to understand when your DUT becomes stable to measure. Then you can set the measurement windows for RF and DC measurements properly and have an accurate measurement data. Another topic I want to point out is low frequency responses of the transistors and how we configure our measurement setup to improve low frequency stability of the DUT. An RF transistor's input impedance always has a negative real part in the low frequency region due to the feedback capacitance between the drain and gate. As an RF amplifier designer, we have to consider negative impedance cases carefully. It's not the only reason for an oscillation, but it's one of the requirements to start an oscillation. This equation shows why most of the designs have a serial resistor on the gate biasing line and RF bypass capacitors at the drain biasing line. In theory, a simple resistor can change the input impedance from a negative value to a positive value easily. Some of the biases do not have these additional components and cannot support the stability of the DUT to have a reliable measurement. Therefore, in some cases, you need to do it manually to improve your setup's stability. As I mentioned in the previous slide, some of the biases do not have capacitor banks and serial resistors to provide a wideband operation. However, most of the time, we focus only AF frequencies for load pull measurements. Therefore, you can include some additional components to the bias T's to improve the low frequency stability, such as capacitor banks and serial resistor structures. I always recommend to measure the wideband response of the bias T if you add some components to your measurement equipment to be sure that it doesn't cause any resonance. And it's obvious that this is not a proper solution for pulse DC measurement systems. Now, time to talk about some important design considerations. In this section of my presentation, I will give some examples showing the importance of harmonics, bias network design, and amplifier measurements with load pull measurement systems. I say design considerations, but there is no reason to extend it for your measurement setup. This slide presents some measured results of a packed 160-watt GaN HAMT. It's published in the European Microwave and Integrated Circuits Conference in 2019 by Ampleon. There are three devices compared in this study. It's a ceramic-packed, high-power RF transistor with and without termination networks in the package. The device A hasn't got any termination network in the package. There are only bonding wires from the gate and source pads to package leads. The device B has a termination at its input, but hasn't got an output termination network for the second harmonic in the package. The device C has both input and output termination networks in the package. When the impedance at the second harmonic frequency is swapped 360 degrees around the edge of the Smith chart, which means in the high reflection region, device B has a reduced performance around 90 degrees. However, device C almost independent than the second harmonic termination. This measurement data shows if the second harmonic is strong enough to manipulate the output waveforms, you have to be careful about how you terminate the DUT's load for the second harmonic. In some cases, you may degrade the performance due to an unknown bad termination for the second harmonic. In this slide, you can see the efficiency and output power performances of the devices A, B, and C. Active source pull and load pull measurements were performed for fundamental harmonics. If there is only load pull for the fundamental frequency, which means that the load impedance at the second harmonic frequency is not set for any specific value, the device C has the best efficiency since it has an in-package termination for the second harmonic. It seems that the load termination impedance at the second harmonic frequency of device B that is caused by the setup is not suitable to improve the efficiency. However, if we look at the second harmonic measurement set, that is done with a second harmonic active load pull, it can reach 80% efficiency. In this case, device C isn't the best efficient one. Probably, it's due to the insertion losses of the termination network. However, it's good to recall that, from the previous slide, its impedance is almost independent of the termination at the package lead plane. In summary, it's obvious that harmonics have significant effects, especially for high power devices, and it's essential to control and measure the harmonics in your measurement setup to have more confidence in your measurements. I want to turn back to biasing networks in this slide to show some simulation results. I shortly explained why we need capacitor banks on the biasing lines and a resistive network at the gate. However, most of the time, it's not possible to find suitable passive component models that can work up to gigahertz range to evaluate the bias networks with the simulation tools. Assuming that the biasing networks just okay could be dangerous for your design. In this figure, there are three analysis results for low frequency range. The blue line shows the real part of the input impedance Z-gate without a resistive network. Z-gate is all negative due to the feedback capacitor of the transistor. If we use a resistor around 10 ohm, the impedance seen after the network, which is Z-total, becomes around 10 ohm. It's the red curve. Up to this point, the RF bypass capacitors were ideal. The black curve shows a resonance in the low frequency range caused by a realistic microfarad value capacitor modeled with a capacitor and inductor. This resonance can trigger an oscillation in the low frequency region. That's why a comprehensive analysis is required to have a reliable design. Large signal measurements are essential for modern modeling and characterization requirements. A well-planned measurement setup and process is the key for a successful and reliable measurement. Knowing how to measure and how to evaluate measurement results is not very difficult with modern measurement equipment and advanced software tools. Most of the time, load pull is used for device characterization. After implementing a power amplifier, 50 ohm equipment are used to evaluate its performance. However, this type of measurement cannot provide enough information about your amplifier's real performance. In that case, why don't you check its performance with a load pull setup? Then you can judge your design with more information. The second issue about 50 ohm based measurement setups, even if you use equipment with a sticker on it saying they are wideband, is that your setup cannot provide a flat 50 ohm wideband termination, and it will affect performance of your measurements, especially gain response and linearity based evaluation such as EVM. Maybe for narrowband applications it's not a big problem. Modern wireless communication signals have complex and wideband modulations. Therefore, assuming that you have a wideband 50 ohm setup is the first mistake in your measurement. I will tell you the correct answer for wideband analysis and measurements. A mixed signal active load pull setup can do it. I wish you oscillation-free, reliable, and accurate measurements. Thanks for your attention. In the next slide, you will see the source list I mentioned during my presentation. Goodbye.